Welcome back to part 4 of the Mortal Kombat series, where we're exploring how to create this look using both Boris effects and other software. In the previous section, we looked at some texturing in Substance Painter and also lighting in Redshift for Cinema 4D. This time we're going to go back into Cinema 4D and take a look at how I set up the animation, but we'll also jump back again into Substance Painter just to take a look at a few updates I made since the last tutorial. So let's jump in. I wanted to start here in Substance Painter because I actually made a few tweaks to the materials. Under the lights in Cinema 4D, I noticed that this pattern along the back of the dragon wasn't quite bright enough. So I came back across to Substance and I just changed the base color for this neck pattern layer just by clicking on the color and just making that a bit brighter. I just made that pop out a little bit more. I also increased the height slightly just to add a little bit more height to that bump. And if I just roll in here, you might notice there's a bit of a sort of a dark halo around the edges, a bit of a dark outline. And that was done just by adding a little bit of grunge using some anchor points in Substance Painter. Anchor points are used to enable height and normal maps to be treated as if they were actually normal, regular geometry so that they can react to any of the generators that you might add. We can actually start to see the dirt generator around the edge of that height map. Definitely recommend looking up the anchor point tutorials on YouTube. So this is this extra dirt pattern layer. Let me just alt click on the mask. And you can see how I've got that dirt a little bit around the eyes and, you know, the certain occluded areas around the ring and the dragon, but mainly around that pattern. And that just helps that pattern feel a little more integrated into this overall material look. And I was noticing in Cinema 4D that these frills along the back were kind of looking a little flat, so I wanted to add a little bit of ambient occlusion, a bit of extra occlusion in that area, and also just along this area here, just to make that sort of stand out a little bit more. Just along here and up in here, and that's just using this layer here, extra dirt. So once again, it's just using a generator with some dirt in there, and then coming in with the paintbrush, using the paint effect, and just customizing that a little bit, removing a little bit from around the rest of the dragon. I kind of liked the little extra dirt that it was adding, but I wanted most of it to be around in this area here. So just a couple of minor adjustments. And because I'm using the Zolotl Live Link plugin, it's really just a case of making the changes and then just clicking the update button. And that sent those materials across to Cinema 4D and I just continue working. So that workflow between Substance Painter and Cinema 4D and Redshift, which is the renderer that I'm using, but you're not limited to Redshift, obviously. You've got other renderers that you can use, including Cinema 4D. It's such a great workflow because I can jump in and out of Substance Painter, make tweaks and update them straight away. Okay, let's just hide Substance Painter. And now back here across in Cinema 4D, let's talk about the animation. I'm not going to walk through it step by step because it really is extremely simple. If I just drag my current time indicator, you can have a look in the different views here. In this right view, you can see how the camera's moving back. So I've animated the camera on its Z-axis, and notice how the logo and all of the lights are rotating. So the logo is actually not changing position, it's just had its pitch animated. You could create this kind of look animating just the camera and rotating the camera, but I find it's just a little simpler just to have the camera moving back on Z and then just rotate the logo. But I spent all that time getting the lighting looking correct. And obviously, if I was to just rotate the logo, it might not necessarily look that good in the at the different rotation. And I might have to adjust my lights and then animate the position of the lights. So I just did it really simply by putting my lights inside the same null as the dragon and the ring, and then just animating the pitch of this null. You can see there's just keyframes for the pitch. As I drag backwards and forwards, you can see that value is changing. It's So it really is quite simple. And this way, the lights are always maintaining their position in relation to the logo, and it stays perfectly illuminated. But I didn't want it to be fully illuminated at the very beginning. Let me just open up the render view, and I'll just activate that. So you can see the camera's nice and close to the logo because I've animated the Z-axis. And the logo itself is reasonably dark. I'm going to give myself a little bit of space here. So not all of the lights are actually fully illuminated at the start of the animation. I've actually animated for most of the lights the exposure. So if I just, for example, click on the key area light and come up to general, you can see I've actually keyframed exposure. So I went through and adjusted each of the specific lights just by a certain amount of exposure, just so it was a little darker at the beginning. And then as the logo rotates back into position, you can see how the light's exposure is increasing and the dragon's becoming more illuminated. I did that because I thought it was a little more mysterious and maybe impactful to have the dragon in semi-darkness at the beginning, so you're not really sure what it actually is. And then as it sort of pulls back into position, then it starts to be illuminated. And you can see, when I talked about that backlight in the previous video, I actually made that blue. But in the final animation, this dragon's going to be on fire, not literally on fire, it's going to be placed over a fiery scene for the first half of the animation, and then for the second half of the animation, it's going to be on an icy scene. So I didn't actually want a blue light behind the dragon when it's supposed to be in a fiery scene. So what I did was I actually keyframed this. So I click on the back one and just click on that. You can see I've keyframed color. So it starts off with this fairly bright orange. And when we hit about the 150 mark, that's when the dragon actually completely finishes its move and it's stationary. And I keep dragging. This is where the icy scene starts to happen. And I just keep dragging through there. You can see how that color's changing. So as the icy scene is transitioning on, the light cast from the backlights, and that's including this one here and also the one that's only on the dragon, this one dragon only, they're both animated from orange to blue. So I was considering my composite when I was doing my 3D lighting. So overall, really simple, just animating the Z position of the camera, the pitch of the lights and the dragon and ring inside a null, and also the exposure of the lights. So very, very simple. And once that was complete, all I had to do was render it out, and I didn't have to render out many passes, just one hero pass. Let's come over to my render settings. I'm going to just turn this off and close it. So you can see I've got a save regular image activated, and I'm rendering out to OpenEXR at 32 bits with an alpha channel and a straight alpha. So that's my hero pass, but I also wanted to have the emissive pass separate so I can add an auto tracking lens flare using Sapphire in After Effects. So to do that, I opened up the AOV manager in Redshift and just added the emission pass and just rendering that as a direct output. So clicking on direct output, and those are my settings there. So really simple. I didn't do any compositing of the different passes in After Effects other than the emissive. So that's the base dragon logo, but this is going to transition from fire to ice. So I really needed a sort of icy version of the dragon in order to be able to make that transition. So let's go back across to Substance Painter, and I'm just going to make myself a little bit of space here. I'm going to turn off the dragon and the ring. That brings me back to my untextured logo. And I've got this ice group here. Let me just turn this on. So I found an ice material on Substance Source and just imported it. This one here, Thin Ice. And then I just made a few slight adjustments. As with other materials that you get from Substance Source, you do have, you know, various parameters in here, things like cracks and all sorts of stuff. So I just tweaked that in the same way that I showed you in the Substance Painter tutorial and got it sort of as close as I could. And I wasn't really happy with these, you know, big flat areas of ice. So I just went in there with another fill layer, which was just set to height. And I just used like a dirt generator in there with a little bit of warp on there just to break up the ice. And also added that neck pattern over the top, because you can see my neck pattern is disappearing. So just duplicated that layer and placed that on top. So that adds that bump on top. And then a little bit more height on top of that. So just building up those height layers. Here I've just used the crystal grayscale image. And also a bit of warp in that as well, just to break that up. So I just wanted to make it look a little bit more like an icy surface. And once again, I've used Substance, Zalotl Substance Painter Live Link plugin, and just rendered that out into a different folder and called that ice. And that was brought into a separate Cinema 4D file, a duplicate of this file, so I didn't mess up these textures. Got that one just here. And here it is. Let's open up the render view again and just take a quick look at this. Now remember, the ice transition is not going to happen until about frame 150, and that's when this is actually stationary. So I didn't have to render anything other than a single frame of this, because I just did a freeze frame in After Effects. So rather than having to render the whole thing, because the transition doesn't start till this is stationary, I just rendered frame 150, which was really handy. And that was definitely by design. So there's the base ice that was rendered out. But I felt that there wasn't quite enough detail in this. I needed a little bit extra. So for that, I turned to MoGraph. Let me just move this out of the way. Turn this one on here, Ice Shards. And see how that adds these tiny little shards of ice over the entire model. I was experimenting in After Effects with displacement maps, and I was getting quite a good, interesting sort of spiky ice look around the edges of the logo using displacement, but I really wanted to have some extra ones kind of protruding from the model itself. And that wouldn't have been possible with displacement maps. So to create this, I just used a few cones and a MoGraph cloner object. So I've got one for the ring and one for the dragon. Let me just open up the dragon one. And I'll just close this up for now. Turn off my camera and just zoom in. So these are little tiny cones that have been placed all over the dragon and the rings. So if I just select the cloner for the dragon, you can see that I have mode set to object, and I have the dragon as the object, and I have clone set to random. And under the effectors, I also have a random effector. Let me just turn off the random effector. So that's the random effector turned off. So all of the clones are the same size. One of them is slightly longer than the other. I have two different cones. But with the random effector, I could just change the rotation and the scale. See, scale is active and rotation, just slightly rotating them to make them look a little bit more like spikes of ice. And the same thing for the ring, just like that. Now, I didn't want to just render this out with the existing ice texture. I wanted to have these ice spikes as another pass that I could composite on top. If I just turned off the dragon, that's not going to be any use, because these are intersecting the geometry of the dragon, and if I just render that out, it'll look like these are just a bunch of cones sitting on top. So I needed to render the dragon out, but not with ice. For that I use black. So just a plain black material. Just like that. So when I come back to my camera view, when I render this out, what we'll see is we'll see only the spikes as they appear when they're intersecting the dragon model. And that's on black, so in After Effects what I can do is just use the screen blend mode and just drop out the black. And that's exactly what I did. So I rendered that out at frame 150 and that became my ice shards pass. And lastly, I had one more pass that I had to create, and that's this one here. Let me just drag these across. So this is, now I don't need the shards, just hide those for a moment. This is just a emissive white material with some ambient occlusion. Just double click this, open up the shader grab. So pretty simple, I've got a redshift color constant node, and that's patched into the emission color in my RS material, and an ambient occlusion node patched into the overall color. So it's just a quick and dirty way of creating a ambient occlusion pass that I can render out, and then back in After Effects, drop on top of the ice, which I'm creating with a combination of this ice render, this ice dragon render, and a bunch of other stock images and Sapphire Grunge and BCC Grunge. And I'm going to map this over the top of that, or place this over the top, just to reintroduce the shadows. So that'll make more sense when you take a look at the next tutorial, which is the compositing in After Effects. So rendering out frame 150 for this, and with the other renders, that's all ready now to composite in After Effects, and I'll show you how I did that in the next tutorial. So thanks for watching. Once again, this is John Dickinson for Boris Effects. To learn more about the various Boris Effects products, or to watch more of these kinds of tutorials, be sure to visit borisfx.com.